Anyone from the panel would like to start discussing something or a question from audience?
Well, let me summarize here, because we were talking about many different sins. So there are standards. It's a kind of a big word. You can put a lot of meanings into it. So I just want to make sure that we understand what we are talking about. So there are several different standards. There are standard ontologies that we want to use for Transmart, and Philippe told us where to look for them. They have these recommendations to adhere to fair data sharing practices. There are some standard ontologies that are free and everyone can use them, and they are recommended if possible, but it's not always possible. That's why we have people developing additional ontologies, and hopefully they will share them with us so we can we don't have to reinvent the wheel every time. We have a similar kind of a project. Maybe we can start a collection of Transmart ontologies somewhere. Okay, so that's one. Then we have the Transmart tree structure, and that's kind of a tricky thing here. On one hand, you want everything to be standard, and SDDM format is great. On the other hand, you want your users that are not regulatory professionals to actually understand what is under all of these different layers. So you want your users to find the data. On that, there is also you want to make sure that your data is loaded in a way that you don't corrupt it, and when you download your data or you run analysis, that it's still the same data as you loaded, and it's the right variables are connected to each other. So on that, you have to have that tree, so you have to have this hierarchy. So that's the only thing that stands between your data and abyss, is this hierarchy in the Transmart tree, because without it, all you have is your subject and variable, one per line. So you have to connect the ones that are related to each other with this Transmart tree design. And on the other hand, you don't really want to have it very deep. So there are some things that you just have to give up. As I mentioned, we load adverse events every possible way, but we don't really load them all the possible ways, because it's simply not going to fit into this category CD, and then you never find them. So we don't really have adverse events loaded as severe, treatment-related, action taken, whatever. And all the other qualifiers. You cannot just take all of the qualifiers that are associated with this particular event and make a tree out of it, because it becomes very impractical. So you just have to, you know, be 80% there and make your users aware that there are some caveats to how this data can be analyzed. And then there is molecular data. So we load molecular data, and we want to be able to analyze this data, and reanalyze it 5 years from now. So we have to have a metadata associated with this molecular data that explains us how the data was generated, what kind of genome assembly, for example, was used to do this RNA-seq. Because the data is normalized, so we get it. It was normalized. It was analyzed with a certain genome assembly, and that data is captured. And there is also this normalization. Alex showed you data in batches and replicates that we have loaded into Transmart before, and as much as we have argued with data owners, they just wanted to have the data the way they wanted to have the data, and there was no arguing with them that it's not going to do them any good in Transmart, because you cannot really average batches, or you cannot average your replicates. Once you created those standards, and Mark now gives the template to a study owner, they don't really argue anymore, because there is SOP to follow, and it says that they have to pre-normalize the data before they load it into Transmart, and they can attach the raw data as a flat file if they want to. That makes life much easier, and it makes this data reusable. We are talking about reusable data, so anyone can come and get the data and do the analysis in Transmart or outside Transmart, but having batches and replicates pretty much was making this data useless within the Transmart. So that's molecular data, and also the normalization has to be described, because it can be, there are many different ways that you can normalize RNA-seq data, and we have a great adventure with tilde data, as Alex has mentioned. When we first loaded, there were CTs, DCTs, negative DCTs, and then there were also adjusted DCTs. And when you look at the value itself, then the adjusted negative DCTs look exactly like CTs, and everyone was getting confused. And in different studies, you had different normalizations, and how are you going to compare what you're going to get? About that, there is another caveat. So I don't know how many of you loaded microRNA-seq data into the microRNA-seq table. That's one of the cute features of Transmart. You have a microRNA-seq table for the data, but no mRNA-seq table for mRNA data. So, oh, microRNA-qPCR, but not mRNA-qPCR. So we've decided to just drop the microRNA qPCR table altogether and never load anything in that table. Because what it does, it just takes your, it expects to get DCT, and it's by default makes them negative when you load them into Transmart, which was very confusing because you don't have a corresponding table for mRNA qPCR. It's just a side note. So many different standards that we need to somehow have guidance for new users. Maybe it will improve the adoption.
Can I ask, has this ever gone up to like the committee meeting, the content committee meeting? Like, have we ever had, I'm not a part of it, so like, I don't know if you guys are, but like the Transmart content committee, wouldn't this be appropriate to discuss there, like a standards? Like, we're all talking like standards.
Right. Mm-hmm.
One of the topics that it's been being discussed, but not never in this type of depth, I believe. Okay. So,
because if we're we're willing to give what we have the standards, and if you're gonna, and then I don't know if you guys, it'd be kind of cool to have like a content meeting and just be like, here is all like the.
Right. And I like what was discussed just right before we all came up here, the idea that here's a couple ideas to be inspired by if you have this type of data or this type of data or this type of, you know, you don't want to inundate a new user with 1,000 different various discrete ontologies that have minute differences, but instead, if you're dealing with clinical trial data where you have various endpoints or, you know, whatever the, if we could take a little step back and kind of see what are the properties that make that type of data distinct that need to be modeled carefully, and maybe just, you know, set out 5 ontologies to choose from.
On behalf
of
the foundation.
Right, exactly.
Like, it sounds smarter.
That these we would suggest are the best ways that we've found to be inspired by.
Yeah. I completely second that. I think this is the kind of composition aspect that could be done. People come, you've got the experience, completely complementary. You've got the experience of coding many different kind of designs. So we're talking about parallel group designs, crossover design, repeated measure designs, which should be coded in a different way because they've got different properties, and they will inform the downstream analysis. You won't be running the same analysis already. So immediately it provides a help and assistance to people the way they will explore the data. And then we go back into the assay modalities. Okay, I'm doing RNA-seq, I'm not interested into the other components, but I want to know how to best represent. And you have this information already. Mm-hmm. So to kickstart people, that's a fantastic resource. And I would say another complementarity with the BioSharing Catalog, for instance, which has a set of minimum information guidelines. And we could cross-check them and say, okay, this tree is Miami compliant, for instance. So immediately you've got maybe an extra feature, which would be from Transmart. You are almost there if you want to publish your data into that compliant aspect of things, and you can brag about this into your to your funding agencies or whatever. But again, it's a kind of a, you know, incentive to use and code the data in meaningful ways.
Like, wouldn't you actually use Transmart then for the more processed data? Because a clinician, they're not going to look at CROMAs peaks, they're really going to look at a gene was mutated or a gene was wild type. The same for high dimensional data. If you have the data, usually it's normalized already and you set a cutoff. For expression data, you can calculate the z-scores now. In Transmart, you can indicate what is overexpressed, underexpressed. So then do you really need the raw data before that uploaded to Transmart? Because what do you want to do with it? There is no analysis that takes it.
No, so they're not really talking about loading raw data into Transmart. So we were doing what we are doing with our customers that demand to have the raw data. The flat file with raw data gets attached to study, so they can just download the flat file. So some of the customers who uses Transmart want to look at the raw data and renormalize them and analyze them with some other tools. So they have that option. But we cannot load raw data into Transmart because other customers who actually want to run analysis in Transmart, they have to have normalized data. So we have established these rules. We only load in normalized data. Raw data for those who really want to have them, they will be as flat files.
Okay, because what we do in Trade is basically we upload the cold data. And then we figured out, like, we try to adhere to the minimal information guidelines, but they are different when you're going to use Transmart. So now we're working on templates that you see, like, okay, it was this GPL platform. This is an article describing the pipeline, where you can find the pipeline, and a hyperlink to the geo if you store array data or to EGA. Basically, a hyperlink directing you to the data, and that is, it saves space instead of uploading a raw flat file.
Yeah, that's if you're loading geodata. If you're loading data that were generated in course of clinical trials, you don't really have that link that you can attach.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, that's true.
For raw data, there are a couple people that I've talked to internally at Pfizer that just flat out don't trust Transmart. And so, like, I just want the raw data. And I'm like, well, it's, like, normalized here. They're like, okay, but just give me it, though.
Yeah, but yes. Transmart is still good for those people because imagine life without Transmart. People don't really stay at the same job forever. So somebody generated great data, and then this person lives, and the data lives somewhere on his computer. Someone else comes in, they hear about this great data that were generated, but you can never find it anymore. So now there is Transmart. You have you analyze data, you have your raw data if you want to, so you can go to this one source and get studies that were maybe done 5 years ago, regardless of where that PI is still here or already left. Hmm.
Based on relational database system. But sequencing data is unstructured. You can come up with very different level of information, okay, depending on your assumption. And for example, your cancer genome is so changed, your reference base gene expression is wrong. So we just assume some type of preliminary assumption. And it works well, especially main ideas, I think, in a heavily affected by microarray-based approach, which is very popular, very practically useful for a lot of data, but it's going to change. The second problem is, in a Transmart, is not scalable. You are not going to deal with 10 million sequencing data.
Oh, I think Pfizer is attempting to do that. Well,
you need to change all structure. Probably you need a NoSQL, and you probably need a kind of distributed analytics.
That's a different discussion. So I think there will be a discussion about 17.1, and I think for the future development of Transmart, there is some discussions about using different databases as a backend to address those issues like scalability, putting more stuff in there. So. It's not going to solve all of the problems right away, but it's moving in the right direction. And it might be more than one Transmart at some point. So there is now there is like a open source Transmart developing, and then there is a professional kind of branch.
Alliance.
Yeah, alliance that is being developed to handle some specific genome-wide association studies. So it needs a huge scale.
And I think going back to my whole little 80%, you know, relax type attitude, we do have to make sure that that we don't look to Transmart to solve every single problem for every single person. No tool will do that. Somewhere earlier, I think it was today, there was mention of, you know, you don't have PowerPoint and Excel and Word and Access and what other Microsoft Office suite of tools all in one thing. It's different tools. Sometimes different analyses, you know, require a different tool, or different users require a different tool. And I think we need to be open to that. And so we need to understand what our users want, and, you know, and do the best we can. But in times, there's always going to be outliers as far as who those users are and what they need. And we just may not be able to serve everyone.
I only see, you know, the expression based in a table.
Yeah, so in Transmart actually has, I don't know what's going on with Transmart or RNA-seq in 16.2, but 1.2.4 was kind of confusing, and I didn't really use the other table, but in 1.2.4 there were two tables where you can load RNA-seq data. One was normalized, and another one was the kind of gene expression level, yeah, normalized gene expression, and another was the call level. So on the level of reads. So, and there are different ways of analyzing the data. So if you're loading is as a gene expression kind of data, then you can do marker analysis or a heat map. And then there was this other table for raw reads data. There is RNA-seq analysis. That's specifically for that reads kind of data. It has a specific package behind it that I don't really remember right now, but I looked it up. And it is described in the manual that you can download from Transmart Foundation, where they're describing it. I think they are mentioning what kind of a package is behind that RNA-seq.
So I think you mean Azure, Azure package?
Azure, yeah.
And it's the table you're talking about is actually the same as the first one. It's only extended with the raw read counts. So you have the raw read counts, and then you have the option to also add the normalized read counts. And then you can use the same data set to do both the differential gene expression for the heat maps, or you can use Edgar and directly from the raw read counts do the redo the analysis.
That's why you have two different options. Those people who subscribe to using HR, they can use HR. Yeah, there are two tables.
Yeah, like, and also there are, what you say, they don't take into account the transcript length. It's actually feature counts being uploaded. So there is a correction for transcript length. And if it, like in trade, if you come to us, then we will explain using a data guide also like this. These are the data types that you can try to upload. And this is then the test that you can do with it. Basically.
Yeah, now it comes to me. I was reading about HR. HR itself does that correction while it's analyzing the data.
I just remembered something I wanted to say in my talk. And I'm going to take this opportunity to have a really awkward segue and say that, which is, made me think about it. One thing that we use a lot, and I'm not sure if anyone else does or not, is the hovers. that you can have on the tree. So we have the ability, you know, to add a little more information about, actually even, I don't know if this is for everyone. I know we actually made a couple changes to how this works, and we made a loader for the hovers because we do it so often and add so much data to it. But we use that a lot to try to explain things so that our the variable
click
length
here.
Yeah, so it just said, you know,
the one you
we did this variable is really, you know, to keep it short, but then we can explain, like, here's what this clinical endpoint was, and, you know, for them to be categorized as obese, that was this BMI range or whatever the thing was. If we feel like there was more that we needed to say about the topic to explain some term, we use that a lot. So sorry. I forgot.
Yeah.
You know, maybe some user stories, you know, why those trees was developed and things like that. So to kind of setting the framework for that, can each of you maybe comment on, you know, kind of recap a little bit on who your user are when you develop the standard for your transmat for your organization, and the a little bit on the process. So similar to what Becky present, then, you know, you have the steps how you approach these problems, because we've seen the end result that's pretty different from all our speakers. So that's something that I think it would recaps on some of our approach here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why we have Philip, and Philip, they already deposited the starter packs. We know everything about that. We have Beckham. And then we have Alex and me, and I don't really know what Pfizer is willing to share about the trees, and I don't really have any power to do that without permission. So,
you know what I think would be even helpful in addition is maybe figuring out what are the axes that we think are important to consider when picking an ontology. So I think one of the things we said is, what kind of user is it? And do you have one type of user or lots of types of users, mm-hmm. right? That's one thing that you should kind of think about as you approach an ontology. I think another one is, what type of high dimensional data do you have? Or what data types do you have? But there's a lot of different sub data types that we could be talking about. Do you have high dimensional or not? Do you have molecular or not? But also, is it longitudinal? Is it one point in time? I think what we should really be talking about are figuring out what of those things are the highlights that really differentiate when you should use one ontology over another.
You're talking about tree ontology, transmat tree ontology.
Yes.
The transmat tree structure as ontology behind it, if you were to select any. So I have exactly the same list as what you said.
Right, okay, yeah.
So have like users, data types, advantage of, you know, what you find this, how this approach work, disadvantage of that you find that it might not work in certain situations. So you don't, other people don't have to try and error on that. If you find out that it doesn't work in some situation, you know, and use cases, and even some guy on, you know, like you who, you know, add the Hoover functions, it really work well. So things like that, that's kind of, you know, things that I kind of capture from different talks here. But maybe we can also, you know, hear from other speakers. Start from Abby, maybe, the other side.
I think we're still sort of experimenting with some of the different niches of the tree structure as we're sort of talking about the, you know, specifically what we're trying to do with the different UI interface actually requires that we organize the tree structure in a specific way because, you know, when you're dealing with an entity attribute database, such, you know, your key value kind of database like Transmart primarily is, you know, the tree structure itself essentially replaces the schema, right? Instead of having columns, you have a tree path that represents a column concept. So we're taking that very much into account. You know, as we're starting to curate our studies, and you know, I think one of the things that might be interesting, I don't know, it's something I've sort of come across from my work, and I'll put it out there, is there may be certain things that we want to sort of take out of the standard You know, there's sometimes there's information that, you know, useful, valuable information that kind of gets buried in tree paths that really sort of belongs as a sort of true first level entity as a col- as a piece of column data. You know, and you know, an example might be longitudinal data. I mean, I think that's sort of in the works going forward, but there may be other pieces. You know, and I guess maybe another example of how to look at that would be, you know, I'm trying to think, things that you wind up sort of doing permutations to enter in, almost like, you know, an endpoint name or something like that. That might be something that be potentially could be a full-fledged column in the SCAR schema rather than, you know, a, you know, an element in the path. And, you know, that might be something to think about. I'm not sure exactly how that would work, but it's just something, an idea I've been kind of kicking around. I suppose one other thing I would mention too is I was actually just talking to some members of the Hive. I had some questions about if you had sample level data, how would you load that differently? And I don't know if that was one of the things you addressed in your talk, unfortunately.
We haven't not really talked about it. Okay. But that's some idea.
That would be, yeah, that would be a good example, I think, of how the tree would radically transform if you were, if you had a number of samples from a patient and you wanted to capture all the metadata, you might maybe have an outcome result associated with a particular sample, which has associated with a particular high dimensional data, you know, some microarray data, and how you would want to structure your tree so that you could tie those things reliably together. You know, and I was talking, I mean, so, you know, I was talking to, I think Joachim was suggesting that, you know, in that case, you essentially make the, you know, concatenate essentially patient ID and sample and make that your new quote-unquote patient ID so that then, you know, the tree is basically sample-centric. You know, even though it's called patient ID, the tree becomes sample-centric rather than patient-centric.
How about that has yours, a huge then summary statistics?
Right.
Yeah.
Right, and then that's a good point. That you're right, that'll break the summary or skew the summary statistics, you know. So, you know, those are some of the questions and some of the tricks, I think, face trying to figure out how to load various types of data.
And I think everyone's facing them in every tool they're dealing with. It's not a Transmart-only problem right now, right? It's is this patient-level data or sample-level data or aliquot-level data? And, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In that sense, isn't it favorable moving to NoSQL so everything is just key value, but you do whatever you want and change the
database? Honestly, I think that would be an interesting thing to do. You know, it's one of the tricks with clinical data is that if you sort of flatten it out and pivot the whole thing out, you wind up with an incredibly sparse matrix, right? And you don't have, you know, you would wind up with a table of thousands of columns long because you don't have, you know, you might have a set of columns that have a high degree of overlap, but then the rest of these things are all sort of unique to the studies. You know, so as a result, you know, that's when you take the approach of doing sort of the entity attribute value, which is sort of done in Transmart, because that compresses that matrix, and then you can pivot later or you know, not pivot at all, depending on if you're just building cohort analysis, you don't necessarily need to pivot. But, you know, a NoSQL approach would be interesting. I know a little bit about, and I played a little bit with NoSQL databases. You can almost imagine having, oftentimes you'll have like a document with a schema, and sort of almost having two sets of schema columns, right? You know, have the document flexible enough that it has a core set of schema columns that you can count on being there. So those would be things like age and name, and you know, that you might have for a patient, or not name, but age and yeah, no, definitely not name.
Social security.
Address. But you know, some of those you know, central kind of common columns, but then have the ability to extend the document and add additional columns that may be appropriate. But then you sort of switch you still have the same problem of curating what those sort of properties of the document would be and making sure that to the highest degree possible, you want to synchronize the same properties across all documents. You know, if you can, you don't want to obviously create, you know, an age one and an age two for no good reason, right? You want to keep them consistent. So it changes the nature of the problem, and it would also probably require a significant redesign of the rest of the application, would be my guess. And but yeah, that is an interesting thing.
That's all kind of forward-looking kind of mm-hmm. wish list.
Yes.
Right. We have problem at hand. We have the Transmart as it is, and we're still going to have it as it is for a couple of releases. Well, at least one more release. It's going to be as it is. So I think if we can just put together a document that will have some guidance about different type of data and how to best load them, and then some case studies, that would probably be very useful for any new people that would like to test Transmart or they use.
Yep. I think we will take that action attempt back to the content committee and definitely try to develop a guide repositories of collections that we've seen in this meeting.
And like Becky mentioned, not too many. Because people don't really want to have so many choices. When I talk with my husband, it's impossible because he's trying to select peas. You have to have 10 different kinds of peas, and he's trying to see what the differences are.
Sometimes so there's freedom in the lack of choice.
Yes. So you want to have some general guidance and few cases where it's where you can highlight different pros and cons of loading data one way or another one, and what kind of users will benefit from a particular Transmart redesign, what kind of clinical trials have to be loaded this or that way. Other things about Philip mentioned metabolomics data.
Right.
I remembered I just curated metabolomics data not long ago, and I found that lipidomics don't fit into Transmart. They have long names that don't fit anywhere.
Okay, that's an interesting one.
I had to come up with some way of shorten them at the same time preserving identifiability of a particular analyte, but that's kind of another issue, another type of ontology.
But again, that makes a case for sharing this representation that you have, because we are working with the European repository for metabolomic data. So again, any bridge between Transmart and a repository so that you could import natively data sets from there would also...
Other metabolomics are fine.
Yes.
Lipidomics, when you have...
Long names, yes. Yeah. But in fact, it's we've been facing the same problem because we've been dealing with stable isotope resolved metabolomics studies, which are also kind of interesting design sometimes. And we need to agree on a kind of agreed upon representation of the results. How do you represent mass isotopomere and these kind of things, and describe them with a naming convention, and which requires shorthand because the names are very long. So, yes.
I didn't really find any other ontology for metabolomics that I can map these long names to.
There is I could point you to a reference, but it's been published recently for precisely discussing shorthands for those. Maybe it will help, but still, I found them very long.
That's another piece of information that we should have there.
Right, I know. I think this is creating this kind of a playing ground where people would, it could be an incentive as well to have different groups deposit data sets or start with a study profile in the form of a Transmart ontology. As a first step before maybe releasing data sets as well. I mean, because that's, we have to take it one step at a time.
Yeah, I think Transmart tree is much easier to release than the data itself.
Well, and a lot of people are putting their own data into Transmart too, and so, you know, that the tree will help everyone. The data sets, publicly curated data sets, will only help a certain group of people. Mm-hmm. So.
Looking at time, we have 3 minutes left. So any last question or comments from the audience?
So you say you got 73 studies with clinical data and 200 with genomics data. Are these all behind closed doors, Becky?
Wait, what did I say?
No, it's 73, it's Alex.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. And then, and then almost 3,000 GWAS analyses.
But are these all private studies, or will they end up in the public domain so that they can also be shared on the eTrix platform?
Wait, which one are you talking about, GWAS or?
For the clinical domain right now, that we can just have a sniffle around as to the
We got a lot of geo studies. I don't remember. Do you know the breakdown? You probably know more than I do.
Well,
we have a good amount of geo studies and public studies in Transmart, and then the rest are Pfizer or collaborative studies. Mm-hmm.
Geo can probably
And we have like ADNI and PPMI and stuff.
Some half of those geo studies they are already on Transmart website. So mm-hmm. there are some geo studies that Pfizer has that maybe. Available.
I can talk to Jay about that. Is that helpful?
Well, did you just take them from Geo and dump them, or did you also structure them for the demographics?
I'm assuming we structured them.
No,
they
are.
No?
We've structured them. Yeah. Pfizer Geo studies are the best because not only we have structured them, we have also renormalized them from the raw cell files, so they are cleaner than the ones that are.
Okay. I can connect with you and chat more about that. But definitely, like, I don't know if I could share the Pfizer studies, but at least the geo.
So I have a dumb question. So I have two schools from the center. One believes GWAS very well. Another believe is just here. So what's the situation currently? GWAS is gaining momentum or somehow?
So at least for Pfizer, for us, I don't know if it's very standard for other pharma, but Jay has told me personally that the reason we use GWAS is power and performance. So there's just so many of them, and you can do a lot with that large of a data set. And it's power and price. That's what it was. And against NGS, I think the last time we were looking at this was 10 years ago, and it was like $50,000 a person to do whole genome. And so I think the solution was GWAS at the time, and now that we have like 3,000 analyses, it's actually becoming something that's very valuable to our analysts. I'm not sure I can speak for the other groups, but I think when people hear that we have 3,000 GWAS analyses, they're like, holy crap. So I don't think it's very standard for other people to have that. Hopefully that answered your question, or at least from Pfizer.
Now the sequencing is cheaper.
Yeah,
it's being used in clinical trials more and more. Not at the end point, but as an exploratory kind of analysis. And I think the GWAS studies that has been done a long time ago when the sequencing was very expensive is not any indication of how this data can be used when you can generate a whole bunch of different sequences. And people are given their consent. So. For now.
All right, I'd like to thank all of our wonderful speakers again. And thank you for everyone for contribution and discussions as well. Hopefully that's, we learned something from each other today, hopefully. All right, so thank you, everyone.